Hi folks, I'm Brother Chad. Welcome to the Masters Lanterns Ministries Online Bible Study. I want to thank you for tuning in. Today's Bible study is going to be a little bit different, but before we go any further, I want to go ahead and give you our contact information. If you'd like to email us, you can do that. Our email address is masterslanterns@gmail.com. You can go ahead and email us with any questions, comments, anything like that. If you'd like to head over to our Facebook page and give us a like, the web address or URL is facebook.com/masterslanternsministries. Normally what we seek to do is exegete a passage of Scripture. We take a passage of Scripture, we examine it carefully in light of its context, and we bring out the available information from its context, from the target audience and their geography and their culture and their language, and also the language of the text. And we try to take into consideration any idioms or, you know, phrases of speech that they use, so that way we can best understand the Scripture in light of what the target audience that the epistle or whatever it was written to, we try to understand it the same way they would have, so we can understand how it applied to them, and then we can gain how it applies to us. I've seen a lot lately of people committing the sin of eisegesis. And yes, I use that term sin in a slightly looser manner, because what I mean by sin when it comes to this is the fact that they're taking just a random scripture and they're quoting a scripture and saying, you see, it means this, and they're ignoring the context, they're ignoring the grammar, and probably context is the number one thing that's being ignored, and it's something that can't be. But what we do gain from exegesis is the proper way Scripture applies to us today, 2,000 years removed from the writing of the New Testament. Now, today we're going to be looking at a passage of Scripture, and today we're going to primarily focus on its application, and I'm going to tell you a story about something that happened to me just last week, and it's something that's really prompted me to make this video. Because I got on Facebook and I talked to some Christian friends of mine on the phone and some other stuff, and what I found out is that most Christians don't know why they believe the Bible or if they can really trust the Bible, and they really don't have any information. So the goal of today's video is really to provide you with information that if someone tries to attack the authenticity and reliability of the Bible, you can give a somewhat decent defense. You may have to watch this video a few times, you may have to take some notes, and that's okay. I'm also going to provide you with a link to a free PDF you can download, and it's going to provide you with a lot more information. In fact, just last night, I right before I went to bed, I downloaded this PDF just so I could update some of my information. I tried looking through one of my old notebooks I would write my sermons in, and I couldn't find the sermon I was looking for, but I was able to gather a few odds and ends here and there, and I was able to make some new stuff that I was able to put on my phone. So anyway, without any further ado, let me tell you what happened, and then we're going to read the Scripture, and I'm going to explain to you what was happening in the Scripture, but then we're going to see how that Scripture applies to us with the type of situation I was in. So I was over at my friend's house last week, and she's a single mother, and the father of her youngest baby was over, and he is very antagonistic towards Christianity. He's an antagonistic atheist, meaning he hates all religion, period. Me and her were talking about Christianity. And, you know, I was an atheist at one time, so I have a little bit of a heads up on his way of thinking and things. The difference between me and him, I was an evangelical atheist, meaning I was an atheist who sought to convert Christians away from their faith to atheism. And on a couple occasions, I even succeeded. But anyway, we were talking, me and her were talking about a Christian teacher and how I really didn't like this guy. And he was upset we were even thinking about discussing religion in his presence in her apartment. And what he ended up doing was he brought up an argument I've heard a few times. And it's an argument I even used. Now, I gotta say, Walter Martin died in 1989. I'm a disciple of his. I'm a student of his, if you will. Meaning, and you know, I didn't even become a Christian until after he died. But he's still my mentor. He's still one of my teachers, because so many of his resources are still available. Kingdom of the Cults, Kingdom of the Occult, so many hundreds of lectures and sermons he gave are still available, and I've listened to hundreds of them. I have them on my phone. I listen to them quite often. I've downloaded them as MP3s. I have a good grasp on how to defend the Christian faith. Well, he brought up this argument, which I had even used, and it doesn't hold any water. But he said, religion is responsible for more deaths than anything else in history. The context was that me and this friend of mine, we were discussing Christianity at the time. So he meant this as an attack on Christianity, on the body of Christ. So all I could do was give a defense. I gave an answer, as 1 Peter 3:15 said, to his objection. And when he said this, I looked at her. She didn't want to deal with it because she's not a believer, but she's also not hostile toward the gospel. She's open to it. And at this point, I have been witnessing to her for the past few weeks, and I wanted to demonstrate that Christianity was not a blind faith. It was not something you just have to take entirely by faith, but we do have evidence. So I had to go back into my Rolodex of a memory bank, and I had to bring up some answers to this charge he had made. And I did so. I posed a question to him, and I said, do you know how many people throughout all recorded history, and notice how I phrased this, were killed by people claiming to be Christians? And he said, no. And he was actually kind of shocked I brought it up. And he was trying to come up with a number, but he really couldn't, because he had never pondered it before. He just used it as a blank attack on Christianity. Well, I told him that years ago at NYU there was a study done, and there was probably approximately 3.5 to 4.5 million people that were killed by those claiming to be Christians. And I said, let's go ahead and be liberal and say it was 4.5 million. And he smiled, okay, you don't think that's a lot? And then I looked at him and I got real serious and I said, but your position is one of humanism or atheism. In the same amount of time, do you know how many people your worldview has killed? And he was absolutely shocked. Because at this point, he said he thought he had me, because it was, oh yeah, 3.5, 4.5 million people, you think that's a lot? Or you don't think that's a lot? But when I brought up his worldview, and he said, oh, well, no. And I said, between 4.5 and 5.5 billion people. So if you ask me, do you think 3.5 or 4.5 million people is a lot? I'll say no, not when you compare it to 4 billion people. Of course, he really didn't know what to say. He was at a loss. And he changed the subject very quickly. And I turned to her and looked, and her jaw was dropped. She had never heard anything like that. And I said, but as he was trying to change the subject, I came back and answered, but you know what? If all those people who were claiming to be Christians were truly Christians, would they have really done such a thing? And he said, well, they're hypocrites. And I said, but you said they were Christians. So what are they? Were they Christians or were they hypocrites? Because if they were hypocrites, they were truly humanists, like you, and they weren't Christians at all. They just called themselves Christians. He changed his subject immediately, and that was it. He wouldn't have anything else to talk to me about. It was not about winning an argument with him, but it was about making a point that he had not done his research and really didn't know what he was talking about. And I was able to successfully defend the faith against him. But then, later on, I was talking with the girl, and she told me, you have to understand his point of view. And I said, believe me, I understand it better than you do. You were raised in a somewhat Christian home. Really, it was a pseudo-Christian home. But I said, you were raised in the church. I said, I wasn't. I was an atheist. I know his positions. And the worst part is, I know them better than he does. And I know his arguments better than he does, because I know both sides, and I actually know his side, and he doesn't even know that. She said, well, you have to understand, he's read the Bible, and he's found all the problems with it. I said, if he has actually read the Bible, then he would not put up some of the arguments he's made toward me in the past, because the Bible flat out rejects most of his arguments. For instance, he talked about how in the New Testament, Christians are commanded to kick people out of the church if they're not going to give money. You don't see that anywhere in the New Testament. He talked about how in Christianity, the New Testament, the Bible, teaches that it's okay to kill certain people if they don't become Christians. You don't see that anywhere in the New Testament. And I brought this up to her. I said, believe me, he's never read the Bible. He's never read the New Testament. And if he has, it's only certain portions which fit his worldview, or portions he can twist into his worldview to make it appear like something that is not true. But today, it wasn't today, but the other day we were talking about it again, and she brought up, well, one of his big arguments about it is, how do we know that the Bible we have today is the same Bible that was originally written? I spent a few years studying this subject, this very subject. And before we even go any farther, I'm going to recommend a book to you. The name of the book is The New Evidence That Demands a Verdict by Dr. Josh McDowell. This is it. It's a big gold book. The New Evidence That Demands a Verdict. It runs for around $30, published by Thomas Nelson, and it is 760 pages. Yeah, 760 pages. It's a big, thick book. I added a bookmark to it. You guys know how I am with my bookmarks. Anyway, I want to recommend that you get that book. It'll be the best $30 you ever spent, and I'm sure if you go on Amazon, you can find copies of it even cheaper. And I know ChristianBook.com, which is Christian Book Distributors, they have it cheaper than $30 as well. I also want to let you know, some of the information in that is dated. It's older information, which is why I went online last night. I actually went and got that book out of storage yesterday, just for the purpose of this video. But I went online last night, downloaded a PDF, and I'm going to provide information on how to get this PDF so you can examine some of the evidence yourself. It might be something you want to download to your tablet, phone, computer, just to keep on hand, just to review for yourself, or even print it out and save a few of the pages and highlight, make your own little notes. But anyway, actually, I'll go ahead and give you that information now. And I took a screen capture of what to search for. Okay. So what you're going to search for is, you're going to go to google.com, and you're just going to do a search for Josh McDowell Bibliographical Test PDF. And it'll be the first thing, It'll be the first thing that pops up. Let me try to show that to you. There you go. That's what you look for. Josh McDowell, Bibliographical Test, PDF. And the first thing that pops up is going to be a PDF from josh.org. And it's going to say the Bibliographical Test. Now, this is updated. And it was updated back in 2014. So, and it was August 2014. But even so, it's still a little dated because they've still been finding more and more manuscripts. But now the question remains, how do you know the Bible that was written back then is the same Bible we have today, or vice versa? Well, first off, let's go ahead and read a passage of Scripture. And we have to realize that this question, when it's asked by an honest person who's seeking answers and seeking truth, it's a good thing, and we have to be able to properly give them the information. But at the same time, we have to be able to give the same kind of information, maybe in a slightly different way, to those who would try to attack our faith with that same question. If you have your Bible, open it up to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, and we're going to read the first five verses. Now I, Paul myself, beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am base among you, but being absent am bold toward you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. In this passage, the Apostle Paul is dealing with a section of spiritual warfare. He reveals to us that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're not fleshly, they're not earthly, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. In other words, the weapons we have, they're not earthly weapons like swords and spears, but they are to pull down other types of spiritual strongholds. And in the next verse he says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. Casting down imaginations or ideas or arguments even. Tearing down arguments, destroying arguments. That's part of the Christian life. And it's part of spiritual warfare. A lot of people look at spiritual warfare and they think of it as something absolutely mystical, where you're praying against demon spirits and things like that. And it's not always like that. A big part of spiritual warfare comes with our day-to-day lives, when people challenge us as to why we believe what we believe. And we need to have an answer for that. Now, I'm going to give you some information. That question, which I know he's going to end up bringing up, and I'm just going to bide my time and wait for it, because I'm not in any kind of a rush. I'm not going to try to bait him into the argument, because I already know what's coming. But he's going to ask me how I know the Bible we have today is the same as the Bible when it was originally written. Well, I've done a lot of research into this years ago, and like I said last night, I just went and I downloaded that PDF, I copied some information into my notepad on my phone, so I already have it on hand and I'm ready to go. I've prepared it in a way that I can go ahead and deal with his arguments as they come up. But now I'm going to try to share this in more of a teaching format for you. So you might want to get your mouse pad ready so you can pause the video and take notes. And you might want to go ahead and get yourself a pen and paper to help you with those notes. There's two words you're going to have to learn: autographa and bibliography. Autographa refers to the original autograph of a manuscript. For instance, Paul's epistle to the Romans. We don't have the original handwritten manuscript, the original handwritten autograph that Paul wrote himself to the Romans, or to the Corinthians, or to the Ephesians, or to the Colossians, or to the Thessalonians. We don't have those. But it also refers to the distance between the original autograph and the earliest known copy. The near and half know what a manuscript is. A manuscript is a handwritten copy of an autograph, or a copy of a copy of an autograph, or a copy of a copy of a copy of an autograph. And we're going to get into a little bit of that, because we're going to talk a little bit about the telephone argument. The second word, or, well, I guess it was three words you're going to have to know, because we've already covered autograph and manuscript. We're going to have to cover the word bibliography. Bibliography is the amount of handwritten or hand-copied manuscripts of an autograph. Not a printed copy, not a printed manuscript, but a handwritten manuscript. Now, right there, let's go ahead. And I can't remember, I just had a thought in my mind. Yeah, like I said, we don't have, I gotta reiterate this. We do not have any of the original handwritten manuscripts that were the original autographs that were actually penned by the authors who wrote them. All we have today is copies. And that's not a problem. Now, I want to give you some information here. And after this information, I'm going to give you a lot more information. First off, I want to look at the second most attested piece of manuscript from antiquity, or from around the first century or before. The second most attested manuscript, and remember, all this information comes from like August of 2014. I think it was like August 13th, 2014. The second place manuscript is Homer's Iliad. Homer's Iliad. It was originally written between the 9th and 8th century B.C. The earliest manuscript that we have of it is from the 4th century B.C. Now that's a time gap of 400 years. So we have it originally being written around the 8th or 9th century B.C. 400 years later is the earliest copy that we have of it. Now, as of August 13th, 2014, there was officially 1,757 manuscripts, with more being found after that date. To this day, there is less than 2,000, but more than 1,800 manuscripts of Homer's Iliad. That's tremendous. That means we can take, and even if we only have a few pages here and a few pages there, we can piece it together. And that's for Homer's Iliad. In fourth place, we have the writings of one of the most brilliant philosophers known in history. His name was Plato. You might have heard of him. But Plato had a writing called Tetralogies. Tetralogies. Now, Tetralogies was written in the 400s BC. The earliest manuscript we have is from 895 AD. That is a time gap of 1,300 years. And we have a total of 210 manuscripts of Plato's Tetralogies. And that is as of August 13th, 2014. Then we have the Bible coming in at number one. The New Testament was written between 50 and 96-97 AD. The Gospel of Mark was written between 55 and 65 AD. The earliest manuscript that we now have, which was actually found, if I'm not mistaken, amongst the Dead Sea Scrolls in the Qumran community, was from, get this, approximately 68 to 72 AD. How amazing is that? So we're within 10 years of the original manuscript and of the original autograph and a handwritten copy of a manuscript. That's pretty amazing. Now, as far as the New Testament goes, as far as early manuscripts from like the first like 3 to 4 centuries, we currently have, as of August 13th, 2014, 5,838. That is absolutely amazing. We have more than twice as many original language Greek manuscripts, which were copies of the autographs. We have more than twice as many for the New Testament as we do Homer's Iliad. Of course, also the New Testament was a bit newer than Homer's Iliad. But we don't stop right there at those Greek manuscripts, because we also have early translations from the first 3 to 4 centuries AD. And those early translations, we have 18,524. That brings us to a total of 24,362, not even counting quotations from the patristic fathers, that's the early church fathers, and from lectionaries. Now, I'm going to give you some information on the Old Testament, but primarily we're dealing with the New Testament. Now, when it comes to the Old Testament, the dating is very difficult, but we know it was finished by around the 5th century or 4th century BC. We have the Dead Sea Scrolls, which date from around 200 to 350 BC. We have collections of other manuscripts from the Green Collection, synagogues, museums, private family collections, codices, Jewish seminaries, and individuals. They are so numerous, we estimate their number at approximately 42,000 manuscripts. Now, earlier I mentioned the patristic fathers going back to the New Testament. They also quoted from the Old Testament, the early church fathers. We have approximately 49,711 quotations from the Old Testament. And those early church fathers also have approximately 36,289 quotations of the New Testament. Now, I got to stop right there, because I have to give you, I'll hold off on that little bit of information I was going to give you now. As far as later translations of the Greek New Testament manuscripts from, say, the 4th or 5th century forward until the invention of the printing press, we have a minimum of 15,000 manuscripts. Now, do the math on just the manuscript copies of the Greek New Testament and translations of the Greek New Testament, and you'll see that we have over 50,000 pieces of manuscript evidence spanning from the first century up until the invention of the printing press. Now, that's some pretty impressive, inarguable historical information. But how do we compute all this? How do we digest all this? And what does it really mean? And why is it really important? This is why it's important. Because if we take those manuscripts from the first century when they were written, and we bring it all the way up till the invention of the printing press, we now have manuscripts scattered between the start date and the printing press. The printing press made it available for everyone to have. Now, let's start there. We have all these manuscripts between the start date and the printing press. Okay? In between these two dates, we have all these different manuscripts. Why is this important? Because the question being answered here, how do we know that the Bible we have today is the same as the original Bible that was written back then? Well, it's very simple. We can take all these different manuscripts, and if someone tried to change something, we're going to be able to record it, and we're going to see it. And guess what? That's actually been done. You know, one argument I've heard from atheists when I've discussed this kind of thing with them is that Christians have tried to hide the fact that there's been changes to the Bible. Well, you know, if we're trying to hide it, we're doing probably the worst job in history, because you can now go get the United Bible Society's 4th edition Greek New Testament, or you can get the Nestle-Aland 28th edition Greek New Testament. And there's something in those called an apparatus. Now, I'm sure most of you are familiar with study Bibles, where you have the text at the top, and then you have commentary notes at the bottom. Well, the apparatus in one of those Greek New Testaments is similar to that, except for instead of having study notes at the bottom, what you have is information on the manuscripts. And what you have as far as that information goes is variant readings, or how different manuscripts will read. Now, of course, if you're getting the UBS 4 or the NA 27 or 28 now, Nestle-Aland 28, if or maybe it is 27, I can't remember, there's so many of them. But it's always being updated. I think it's 28 right now, or 27. Yeah, either way. So if you go get the latest Nestle-Aland, it is 28. If you get the latest Nestle-Aland 28th edition Greek New Testament, or if you get the United Bible Society's UBS 4 Greek New Testament, all that's going to do is cover the Greek manuscripts and all their variant readings. And it is going to do its best to accurately record any variation between one manuscript and another. Now, if you were to look at one, it is slightly bigger than a standard straight Greek text New Testament, because, you know, it's looking at like how many thousands of manuscripts. But also, it's an amazing thing, because when we look at this, we can take all the information provided. Let's say we're looking just at, say, John chapter 3, or even better yet, John chapter 1. We're going to see any little variations. For instance, if you look at John chapter 1, and you look at verse, I think it was 18 or 19, and if you have a New American Standard or an ESV, it'll probably bear this out. Verse 18, John 1:18. In the King James it reads, "No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him." Now, if you look at something like the New American Standard or the ESV, it's going to read, "Only begotten God has declared him." And that's a simple thing. It's a variant. It's a difference in the Greek manuscripts, because a couple of the Greek manuscripts read in Greek, monogenos, only begotten, theos, meaning God, while the others read monogenos, huios, only begotten, Son. So it's a difference in the manuscript. But here's the thing, when you look at it within its context, because those first 18 verses of John, that's just the introduction to John, those first 18 verses. And you know what you find out? That either way you read it, it doesn't change the meaning. Not at all. One is declaring the sonship of Christ, while the variant reading, only begotten God, is declaring the deity of Christ. But if Christ is the Son, he is God. And if Christ is God, who is he but God the Son? Because he declares in John 3:16, he is the Son of God. So that's just an example of a variant and how a variant can change the way a text reads, but it doesn't change the overall meaning of the text. The doctrine is still there. The doctrine is still complete. And that's how a variant works. And those are the types of variants we deal with when we're dealing with Greek New Testament manuscripts. And you know what? You can take all the variants you want. And if you get something like the New American Standard 1995 update, or if you get an ESV, which I prefer the New American Standard update, it's more accurate than the ESV. But if you were to take and compare those, compare a King James Bible based on the Textus Receptus, and you compare the 1995 update of the New American Standard, you know what you find? They say the exact same thing, but in a slightly different way. That's what you're going to find. They still contain every single major doctrine. Every one of them. There's no real differences there. 1611 versus 1995. You're looking at almost 400 years. And yet, they still read basically the same. Or it still communicates the exact same message, at least. So how do we know that the Bible we have today is the same Bible that was originally written? Because we can look at the manuscripts written from the 1st, 2nd, 3rd centuries. We can compare them to manuscripts from the 13th, 14th, 15th centuries. And even though there may be slight little differences, everything still means the same within its context. That's why hermeneutics is so important. Hermeneutics is the art, science, and practice of interpreting scripture. That's why exegesis is so important. That's where we look at the context, the grammar, the syntax, the history, the culture. We look at all these things. When we're looking at a passage of scripture, we bring it all out. So the next time I meet that friend of mine, and he asked me that question, and I know he's going to ask it, how do we know that the Bible we have today is the same as what was originally written? I can tell him because we have 1,500 years of manuscript evidence, and we can compare a manuscript from the 1st century or the 2nd century, and we can compare it to a manuscript from the 5th century and the 8th century and the 10th century, and we'll also have other translations from the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th centuries. We can take all these manuscripts. Christianity has already collated them. It's already gathered them up, counted all the differences, and it continues to do so. Every year, dozens of new manuscripts of the New Testament are being found. And every year, they're being read very carefully, and all their differences are being documented. And now, hopefully, every few years, we're going to be getting a brand new edition of the Greek New Testament from something like the United Bible Societies, or like something like the Nestle-Aland Greek New Testament. Because what we find is the more manuscripts we get, the more the authenticity of the Bible is being verified. The more manuscripts we get, the more evidence we have saying the Bible we have in our hands today is the same Bible they had when it was originally written. We have manuscript evidence. But we also have textual criticism, and that's what I've been talking about. When I say that we have something like the Nestle-Aland 27th or 28th edition Greek New Testament, we have all those variants. That's used for the science of textual criticism. That's used for comparing the different readings and trying to go back to what the original reading was. Christianity is not an enemy of scholarship. Christianity is at the forefront of scholarship because, contrary to popular belief, we don't try to hide things. We bring them out in the open. And we say, this is what the evidence says. We have nothing to hide with our faith. I'm sorry, I'm kind of getting a little preachy here. But anyway, that's going to be the answer. I'm going to encourage you once again, if you want to do some research for this yourself, and you want to see how reliable, how accurate is the Bible, especially the New Testament, once again, I'm going to recommend Josh McDowell's The New Evidence That Demands a Verdict. I'm going to recommend go on YouTube and just search for Josh McDowell. That's all you have to do. Go on YouTube, search for Josh McDowell. You're going to come up with several of his lectures, sermons, whatever, and he's going to be discussing these things. The authenticity of the New Testament, the manuscript attestation of the New Testament, the evidence for the New Testament from the manuscripts, stuff like that. He's going to discuss all of it. And there's tons of that kind of stuff from Josh McDowell on YouTube. Now, on top of that, getting Dr. McDowell's book is great. Listening to some of his teachings are great. He's got other books. If you have a friend who's maybe questioning stuff about the New Testament or about Jesus Christ, he wrote another book. And you can get them in 6-packs and 12-packs for giveaways. It's called More Than a Carpenter. And it's a real simple, easy book, real short. And you know what? That would be a really good gift to give. So yeah, how do we know that the Bible is authentic? Because the manuscripts tell us it is. That's how we know our Bible today, 2016, is the same as it was around 100 AD. We know it. So anyway, folks, this is Brother Chad with Masters Lanterns Ministries. I'm going to encourage you, contact us if you have questions or comments. Our email address is masterslanterns@gmail.com. Our Facebook page is facebook.com/masterslanternsministries. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to contact us. I'm going to be posting this video directly to Facebook and also to our YouTube channel. Hope you enjoy it. If there's any prayer requests also, please feel free to email those to us. Until next time, keep your light shining. May God bless you. Hope you've enjoyed the video. Hope it's been beneficial. And have a great day.